love with you, for you are good, you are mighty, you are holy, and Lord, you are a loving and good God. And Father, today we just pray that our voices were honoring to you. Father, as we lifted our voices to you in praise and glory and adoration, Father, Lord, we just pray because we're thankful, we know that it pleases you. And Father, it pleases us to hear your word, so we ask that you would open up our spiritual eyes and ears and hearts, Lord God, to receive the lessons out of your word today. So we pray that now, God, as we open our Bibles, that you would speak to our hearts and make application of your word. For it's in your name we pray. Amen. You may be seated this morning. Praise the Lord. Isn't God good? Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. If you're visiting with us today, we study our way through the Bible. We're going book by book, chapter by chapter, verse by verse. We go all the way through it. It's my personal conviction that that's the way God gave it to us. That's the way we should study it. So we're in the New Testament Gospel of Luke. Luke's Gospel, chapter 22, is where we left off, and that's where we'll take off. But we've got a couple other portions of Scripture I'd like you to find and just mark. So, Darrell, if you'll put there on there, they're very close to our text, but I want us to look at those here as we get into our study. But Mark's Gospel, chapter 14, go ahead and find and mark that. Then also John's Gospel, chapter 18, we'll be looking at in our study. If you don't have a Bible and wish to study along with us, we do have some at the front and the back of the church. You're welcome to those. While you're finding those chapters, I want to say one more thing about the trip to Mexico. I don't know if you guys noticed or not, but in the pictures, you might have noticed how everyone was wearing purple. Did you notice that? Well, it's interesting the reason why they were all wearing purple in the Mexico church. And that is because I automatically call her Mama Lucy. Pastor Lucy's youngest son, I don't want to say is battling cancer. He's kicking cancer's behind. And the church is standing with her. And so in support of Philip, her son Philip, they all wore purple. And it was a very neat stand that they took as a church to help come against that situation. So very moving. Praise the Lord. You guys got your Bibles? Got all that? Everything found and everything? All right, well, we're going to start in Luke 22. And we left off at verse 24. Now, you'll recall in our study, if you're studying along with us, and if you haven't, and this is intriguing to you, we have CD copies you can get. We have all our lessons on podcast. They're on YouTube. You can follow along, catch up with us. But where we are in the life of Jesus in the Gospel of Luke is we're in the last night of Christ's life. What we saw last week and what we studied is what we call the Last Supper, or the institution of and the introduction of communion. We talked about that, and then we celebrated communion as a church, and we saw how it affects us and what it means for us and all of the great things about communion. We saw how it was not only something for us to remember as they were celebrating the Passover, celebrating how God had released them from Egypt's bondage to take them into the promised land, but it also encourages us to look forward. Jesus said, do this in remembrance of me. The Apostle Paul in his letter to the Corinthians said, as often as you do this, you're proclaiming the Lord's death until he comes. So we look backwards at what Christ did. We look forward to what Christ is going to do. And we're also challenged to look inward into our own life, to examine ourselves and see how we're doing with our Lord. And we covered all that last week. So we're still in the upper room. We're still in this very solemn frame of mind and doing all this. And I've got a confession here. I get a kick out of that game show, The Family Feud. Y'all watch that? The bloopers are the best part, right? But I mean, we're trying to promote peace and love and all that stuff. And here we get two families fighting. It's awesome, right? You know? And, well, guess what? Christians aren't immune to that. And so I call this next part Feud to Be First. And I was trying to think of a clever way to make this a game show and do a little skit for you here, but I couldn't figure it out. So just kind of bear with me on here. The feud to be first. Notice verse 24 here. Remember, they just had the Last Supper. They're just doing all this stuff, and Jesus is being serious with them. And Jesus said, one of you at this table is going to deny me. And so they're all saying, well, I'm not going to do it. And that, ladies agree with me here, right? You challenge a dude on who's greatest, there's going to be a problem. Right? Look at the problem. Verse 24. Then there arose a dispute among them of which one of them should be the greatest. And so Jesus steps up here and he gives us this great, great lesson. Verse 25. He says, the kings of the Gentiles being not only non-Jews, but people who are without God, the worldly systems, they exercise lordship over them, and those who exercise authority over them are called benefactors. A benefactor, the definition of that is somebody who gives service, somebody who serves the people, right? Well, he's saying the Gentiles have got this so perverted that these people who are supposed to serve, they're lording it over the people. Does that sound like some politicians today? Right? You know, they're instead of being servants of the people, they're lording it over the people. That's what Jesus is saying. You guys are acting like a bunch of heathen here. Now, this goes against... I hear that more than you realize. Uh-oh. I really do. Jesus, out of the mouth of babes. Don't you just love it? Weren't you all blessed with those little ones quoting scripture in Spanish? Oh, it was just so... Oh, it was so cool. So cool. Anyway, Jesus gives us a great lesson here. And Dara, if you'll put on the overhead, please. It's a familiar portion of Scripture, but it's Isaiah 55. And we need to understand this. When we start studying some things about the Lord and how He does things compared to how we do things, and God is saying to us here, my thoughts are not your thoughts, nor are my ways your ways, says the Lord. Haven't you experienced that in your life? How many of you are like me and in your prayer time tell God how to answer your own question, right? And He never does. He says, my ways are not your ways, says the Lord. Then He gives us a little description. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways and my thoughts than your thoughts. Let me kind of break this down. God is saying, you may not understand it, but trust me with what I'm doing here. I might be doing something different than the way you think it should be done, different than the way the world does it, but you can trust me that I got it under control, right? And don't we sometimes think God doesn't have it under control? I mean, when we get that diagnosis that no one wants to get, when someone we love gets themselves in trouble or something happens and we think God's out of control, right? This whole study and the rest of this chapter is the bottom line of it is we can trust God. Let's keep reading. He says, you know, you guys are acting like the Gentiles, like the unsaved world. I'm at verse 26. He says, but not so among you. You as believers, you as my disciples, you as Christians today, we're not to be acting like the world. We're not to be handling things the way the world does. He says, on the contrary, you know, boy, this is so going against our grain. Jesus says, he who is greatest among you, let him be as the younger. Now, in that day and age, right, it had to do with age and where you sat in the ladder and all that stuff. And so he said, no, the greatest, you need to act like the lowest. That's how I do things. And he who governs as one who serves. Look at verse 27. For who is greater? Now, he gives a practical illustration here. Who's greater, he who sits at the table or the one who serves? Well, is it not the one who sits at the table? And in our mind, we're saying, yeah. Yet I am among you as one who serves. Jesus, the greatest ever, he says, yet I'm here and I'm the great. I'm serving you. Now, theologians aren't sure exactly where in this narrative the foot washing thing takes place, but it takes place somewhere here in this discussion. John's gospel records that where Jesus takes the towel and washes their feet. Luke doesn't record it, but it's somewhere in this lesson that he's teaching the disciples. Now in verse, for the overhead, please, Mark 10:43. Yet it shall not be so among you, but whoever desires to become great among you shall be your servant. So with God, the way to become great is to become a servant. It's to become a servant. Let me ask you guys something totally off this record here. Are you guys too cold? Okay. I got some people out there shivering, and I don't know if it's the Holy Spirit. And I got some of you fanning yourself. I don't know if that's the fire of the Spirit. I'm sweating. I'm sure that's not anointing. So I'm just making sure. Okay. All right. He says, now in verse 28, he acknowledges the disciples' faithfulness through all this. He kind of brings it back, and he says in verse 28, but you are those who have continued with me in my trials. Now remember, they've been with him for 3 years, and they've seen a lot of amazing stuff that happened with Jesus, and it's very interesting. John's Gospel, chapter 6, beginning at verse 666. There come a time that Jesus was preaching, and man, he was being tough on the people, and it got everybody mad, and everyone got up and left the church. Well, they were outside, but everyone got up and left. I mean, I've preached some bad sermons, but two or three people stayed. You know, my wife and kids, you know, because I had the keys to the car. But everyone leaves, and Jesus turns to the disciples, and he says, are you going to go too? And Peter says this, and friends, this is awesome. Peter says, where would we go? You hold the keys to eternal life. You are the Christ. Friends, sometimes God's going to do something a little bit that might make us uncomfortable. His word might challenge us on something, and we might not like it. But his words are the words of eternal life. And he is the Christ. And Jesus is acknowledging these 12 guys' faithfulness to stay with them. And trust me, friends, God knows your faithfulness. He knows your faithfulness, right? Now, this next verse applies just to the 12, but we're going to get some rewards too. But check out the 12 here. He says in verse 29, and I bestow upon you a kingdom just as my Father bestowed upon me, that you may eat and drink at my table in my kingdom and sit. Now, we all get to be part of that. Amen. You know, are you ready? You know what my favorite hymn is, don't you? When the rolls are served up yonder, I'll be there, man. Right? You know? But we all get part of this promise. But now this next part is exclusive to the 12, and I've got scripture proof to that. He says to the 12, and you're going to sit on thrones judging the 12 tribes of Israel. We won't turn there, but write in your Bible, and I encourage you to further your studies. But in Matthew 19:28, Jesus says the same thing to the 12. Now, we won't get these thrones. We won't get what they get, but God's got something good in mind for us. We can trust him for whatever reward, whatever we're going to do. We can look forward to an eternal reward. And so he assures them of this. Now, as we get into verse 31 through 34, I was going to do a little skit for you here too, and then I thought that just probably would not work. But visualize this, if you would, for me, please. Visualize a wedding. Say there's a wedding up here, and you got a beautiful bride, one side. You got, so-so looking groom. Then you got me. You visualizing this? And visualizing this beautiful ceremony that the bride and the groom are exchanging vows that they have prepared for each other. And that's always, always very beautiful. But say they're exchanging vows and I go, wait, hold up. I got some news for you two. You guys are a train wreck. You're not going to last 6 months. You're selfish. You're lazy. Can you imagine that happening in a wedding? That is what I call a forecast for failure, right? Now, we're about to read a forecast for failure, but we can learn some great things. Check this out. Peter's thinking, I'm the greatest dude that ever lived. I walked on water. You sank. Hey, it don't matter. I still walk, right? I had the nerve to get out of the boat while you guys didn't, right? So he's got some bragging rights and all this stuff. But check out verse 31. Now we can learn some stuff here. The Lord says, Simon, Simon. Now, in your Bible reading, friends, when Jesus repeats something, when God repeats something, that's like, pay attention. This is very, very important. Remember when your mom would use your middle name? You knew it was important, right? Y'all know what my middle name is? Oliver. That's a family name. My cousin Ted, Oliver. That was our grandpa's name. But if I ever heard Clay Oliver, scary, right? Well, Peter is hearing Simon Peter. Indeed. Now, I'm kind of horsing around, but this is serious. Peter, Satan has asked for you. Now, in the original, that word you there is in the plural, so he's addressing the disciples, and I believe he's addressing us. Satan has asked for you. Here's the purpose, that he may sift you as wheat. Now, let's look at some lessons that we learn from failure here. Because we know that Peter will fail Jesus. He will deny Jesus. I don't know if we'll get to that today, but he will. But look at seven things here in just these few verses of Scripture. And the first thing, friends, it's necessary we understand this. The first thing is that the devil wants to hurt you. He doesn't want to help you. His lie is that he wants to help you. He wants to benefit you. That's what he told Eve. Hey, man, you do this little sin and you're going to be God, right? You know, he wants to hurt you. He's not here to bless you. He wants to sift you, okay? And also we need to learn that no one is immune to Satan's attacks. This leads to point number two we learn in verse 31, and that is that the closer we get to Christ, the more Satan wants to challenge, tempt, and hurt us, right? If Satan never bothers you, your walk with God probably isn't that good. Now, I don't mean to be cruel. I don't mean to pop your bubble. But if you're no threat, what's right? And so don't freak out if you're doing something for God and all hell breaks loose. When you invite Jesus Christ to be your Lord and Savior, when you start making the decision, I'm going to walk for God, don't expect hell to stand up and applaud you, right? He wants to sift you like wheat. He wants to tear you up. And the third thing we see here is in verse 32. Let me read verse 32. Jesus is saying, but I have prayed for you that your faith should not fail, and when you have returned to me, you will strengthen your brethren. The third thing we see here in verse 32 is that no matter how much we're attacked, Jesus is always there to help us. Isn't that great? Jesus is interceding for us. He has given us his Holy Spirit to strengthen us. He's given us the word to build our faith up. No matter how much we're attacked, Jesus is there. Also notice, please, the fourth thing, that Satan is limited. He is limited. The best example of that is Job. We see in the first chapter of Job when Satan is doing his thing and God says, hey, have at it. The only thing you can't do is you can't kill him. Right? And also remember, Job didn't have the benefit of reading Job chapter 1 and 2. Right? You know, I mean, if he had chapter 1 and 2, maybe chapters 3 through 63 or however many there are wouldn't have been so bad. But he didn't get that benefit. I've got to, for the overhead, please, 1 Peter 5:8. The Apostle Peter, who went through all of this, warns us. He warns you and I, and this is for us today, friends. Be sober. Be vigilant. Well, why? Because your adversary, we have an adversary, the devil, he walks about like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. Once again, he's not our friend. He wants to harm us, not help us. And we need to be very much aware of that fact. We need to be aware of that fact. The fifth thing we see here, it's still in verse 32. You will recover. I almost said you can recover, but I changed that. You will recover. The only reason you would never recover is because you, not because of God, not because of the devil. Because of you. You will recover. Jesus said, when you return, then you'll strengthen your brethren. For the overhead, please, one more. Romans 11:28. I've got to tell you, this ministered to me a number of years ago when I really thought I messed up, that there, no, No. This is a strong, strong verse. We're told that the gifts and the callings of God are irrevocable. The old King James says are without repentance. What that means, friends, is God doesn't change his mind on you. Do you not think God knew David would mess up, but he still anointed him king? Do you think God doesn't know you're going to mess up, but yet he still called you? Now, we can slow down our gifting. We can slow down our calling. We can delay our obedience, but God won't take it away from us. Isn't that incredible? That's one of those higher than my way thoughts, right? So he says, when you come back, Peter, I want you to strengthen your brethren. This brings us to the next thing, and that is that God will use our failures to help others. We're told that we will comfort others with the same comfort with which we have been comforted with. What that means is whatever trial you go through, whatever attack Satan has thrown at you, whatever you get through, whatever happens to you, believe it or not, there'll come a day when God will send someone in front of your path going through that same thing. And you know what will happen? It'll be an amazing thing. God will be able to, you know, maybe the situation, you can put your arm around their shoulder and say, hey, when I walked through that path, here's what God did for me. Here's how God got me through this. Right? And friend, God will use what Satan has intended to destroy you. God will use that to bless someone else. Isn't that an amazing thought? That is so cool. Well, there's some more things, but another thing, the seventh thing here, what the devil means for bad, God uses for good. That great scripture we all know, for all things work together for good for those who love and are called according to his purposes, right? Well, notice what Satan asks. Satan says, I want to sift you guys. Okay. Satan, in his scheme, he views you and I as the chaff, the chaff, I can't ever say that word. But God looks at us as the wheat. The sifting process separated those two. Okay? It was a lot of work. It could be kind of painful and monotonous. But Satan, he wants you to be the useless, destroyed part, the chaff. God sees the wheat. He told us the parable of the wheat and the tares, right? We're valuable. Understand this about this sifting process. Satan will tell you you're useless, you're worthless, you have no value. He'll try to blow you away. That's what in this sifting thing, what they would do is they would throw the wheat up in the air. The heavy grain would fall down. The light chaff would blow away. Satan wants to blow you away, get rid of you. You have no use, right? But God uses that. He says you are valuable. I have a purpose for you. You're going to bless other people. You're going to be blessed, right? He's got a purpose. Three quick things here before I give you these three things. In your mind, go back to James chapter 1. James chapter 1, you don't have to turn your Bibles there, just because we're not going to read it. I'm just going to summarize it. James chapter 1 is a very interesting chapter in the Bible because it talks about rejoicing in temptations. It talks about trials. It talks about testing. It talks about Satan does this, God does this, and it gets kind of confusing. But this scripture gives it clarity because what happens in James chapter 1 is we see the devil trying to sift you. But we see God cleansing you. Check this out about sifting. If you're a good farm guy or gal, you'll know this. When you sift the wheat, sifting was for the purpose of purifying the wheat. It was a process to purify the wheat. Okay? It wasn't done for the destruction of the wheat. It was done for the purification of the wheat. That's what God does with us. Does this all make sense? The second purpose of sifting was for the purpose of exposing the chaff. I hope I'm saying that right. You guys, after church aren't going, can you believe he called it chaff? And it's really chafe. Doesn't he know it's a chafing dish? Not a chaffing dish. Yeah. Bear with me here. I'm from... I went to offer for you. So. It's like, I can't spell. I can't do math. But Satan wants to expose all the bad things in our life when God wants to purify us from those bad things. Right? The Bible tells us that we're to restore brethren that's been found in a fault. We're to help them to recover. But Satan and the tabloids say, oh, we got to expose this and ruin this guy's life. Right? The gifts and call of God are without repentance. Now, you will have some responsibilities if you mess up, but God will restore you. When you return, Peter, you strengthen your brethren. The third thing about sifting here is it was done, this is important, it was done to separate the wheat from the chaff. They were never meant to stay together. And friends, one of the problems with the modern church movement is they don't separate the bad from the good. They're saying you can get away with the good because God loves you. God does love you. That's why he's called you to a better life. Make sense? So how do you start separating the bad from the good? Well, we need to be people of prayer. We need to be people of the word, Bible reading. We need to be people of fellowshipping with each other, building each other up. Iron sharpens iron. Forsaking not the assembling ourselves, we must separate from evil, right? All of that God does for us. Now, the Lord makes it easy. Notice in verse 32, he says, I'm praying for you. I got some great scriptures for the overhead. Romans 8:34 and 8:27. Check these out. These are awesome scriptures. Who is he who condemns? It is Christ who died and furthermore is also risen, who is even at the... This is what Jesus is doing right now. You ever wonder what Jesus is doing? He's at the right hand of the Father who makes intercession for us. You know, we call the prayer chain and say, will you pray for me? You bet I'll pray for you. But I got even better news. Jesus is praying for you too. That's awesome, right? That's pretty cool. Romans 8:27, same chapter. Now he who searches the hearts knows what the mind of the Spirit is, because check it out. He makes intercession for the saints according to the will of God. Isn't that so cool? Jesus says, Peter, I'm going to pray for you. Jesus says to you and I right now, I'm praying for you. That's awesome. Now check this out. Hebrews 7:25 and 1 John 2:1. Hebrews 7:25. Therefore he is also able to save to the uttermost those who come to God through him. It doesn't matter what your past is. It doesn't matter what you've been involved in. God will save you. Thank you. Since he always lives to make intercession for them. That is so cool to me. 1 John 2:1. My little children, these things I write to you so that you may not sin. The chaff has got to be separated from the wheat. So I'm praying that that'll happen. But if anyone does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, the Lord Jesus Christ the righteous. Peter, Satan's going to give you a hard time, and buddy, you're going to fail. But I've prayed for you. And Jesus prays in faith because he says, when you recover from this thing, you're going to strengthen your brethren. Isn't that awesome? That is so cool. That is so cool. Well, let's move on. I got verse 33. Peter, who's overconfident, he's thinking he's the greatest. He says, Lord, I'm ready to go with you, both to prison and to death. He's still depending upon his flesh, and he meant it at this point. 1 Corinthians 10:12, if you put that up there. Therefore, let him who thinks he stands take heed lest he falls. That's a good warning for all of us, right? You know, Oh, that never happened to me. I never. Be careful, dude. Or dudette. Whatever matters. Whatever happens there. Now, Peter's sincere here. Hey, I'm ready, Lord. I'm ready. Verse 34, the forecast of failure here. He says, I tell you what, Peter, the rooster shall not crow this day before you've denied me three times that you don't even know me. This is going to happen when we get to verse 54. I don't think we'll get to there today, but let's see how far we get here. Verse 35. And he said to them, now they're getting ready to leave the upper room. They're getting ready to go to the garden, and they don't know it yet, but Jesus knows this arrest is going to happen. The crucifix is going to happen, and everything's changing. This is very serious and solemn. The situation's changed for him. So he says to them, when I sent you out without a money bag, without a knapsack, without sandals, did you lack anything? Now, just in Luke's gospel, it's recorded. This is recorded in chapter 9 and then again in chapter 10. You know, he sent him out and told him, you just depend on God. Don't depend on yourself. Don't depend on people. God will take care of you. And they said, yeah, we remembered. We lack nothing. Verse 36, and he said, well, now, okay, situation a little bit different. And friends, in our life, I think where we are in God's calendar, I think we're seeing a little different situation also. I think we need to start being a little bit smarter as Christians. Not depending on self, but just being a little bit smarter. He says, but now, he who has a money bag, let him take it. And likewise a knapsack. And he who has no sword, let him sell his garment and buy one. For I say to you that this which is written must be accomplished in me. Now he quotes Isaiah 53:12 about what's going to happen to him. He says, and he was numbered with the transgressors, for the things concerning me have an end. He's saying, fellas, it's time. I've been warning you now 9 times that I'm going to suffer and die, and you guys aren't really paying attention, and it's about to happen. And so they said, verse 38, look here, we have 2 swords. And he said, that's enough. Okay, that's cool. You know. Now we move out to the garden, and let's look at this prayer. As we move into the garden, the word Gethsemane means crushing, the crushing of olives. And I think this is the most powerful, powerful portion of Scripture that we have of Jesus, because here we're going to see Jesus, the Son of God, grappling with grief. Here in this garden, we're going to see Jesus the man and Jesus the God. And friends, I'm going to say this, and if you don't mind writing in your Bibles, write this over verse 39. If you don't want to write in your Bible, lean over and write it in the person next to your Bible, because you got to get this. The victory of Calvary is won in the Garden of Gethsemane. Okay? The victory of the cross was won right here. Let's read this. Okay, we're going to see Jesus going through this. We're going to see Jesus deal with worry, fear, anxiety, and all this stuff. Look at verse 39. Coming out, he went to the Mount of Olives, and we know it's at the Mount of Olives where this Garden of Gethsemane was. In fact, if you go over there to the Holy Land, they have gardens over there, and they'll tell you this was that garden. They got trees that they say are 2,000 years old. I don't know if it's true or not, but it's pretty impressive, I understand. But they go out into this garden. Notice it was he was accustomed to do this, and his disciples followed. Here's the first thing, if you're taking notes, the very importance of winning victory is, number one, follow where God leads. Follow where God, even if it's dark and scary, even if you don't quite understand it and it don't make sense, friends, we can trust God to follow him wherever he leads. They followed him to the garden. The next point here, I don't have an exact scripture for it. It's in the whole narrative here, but it's this. We can rise above our enemies and our adversaries when we kneel before God. If we want to rise above these trials, if we want to rise above hard times, if we want to rise and get victory, we need to kneel before God. Friends, if your prayer life is just praying before your meal, your prayer life needs some work. Okay? I mean, we need to be people of prayer. Check this out. They go out there in verse 40. When he came to the place, he said to them, "Pray that you may not enter into temptation. We need to make prayer a consistent and a steady part of our life. Notice it said in verse 39, as was his custom. You know, if Jesus had to pray, how much more do we need to? Right? Jesus was able to go through what he went through on the cross because he prayed in the garden. The disciples, we're going to see, they didn't pray. They fell asleep and they freaked out at a little bit of trouble, right? So the victory is won in Gethsemane. Let's keep reading verse 41. And he, of course, Jesus, he was withdrawn from them about a stone's throw, and he knelt down and prayed. So we read from the other Gospels that the bulk of the guys stayed at the gate. Peter, James, and John went with him into the garden, and now he separates from Peter, James, and John for a stone's throw. However, to me, that wouldn't be far. Some people can throw it farther, but however, he distanced himself a little bit, and now he's praying. I learned something here, too, and that is that although corporate prayer is very necessary and important, we also need private prayer. All right? Both of them are very, very important, very powerful. So verse 42, he starts to pray. It says here, he prays, "Father, if it is your will, take this cup away from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but yours be done." Here's point number three. Point number three is sometimes prayer is hard work. We're going to see in verse 46 that Jesus finds the guys asleep. I'll be confession time here. I've fallen asleep praying before. I have to pray either on my knees or standing up. I can't do it in a chair. I can't do it laying down in bed because I'll fall asleep. I'm just, you know, I call it resting in the Lord, but that's just an excuse for falling asleep. Right? You know, I'm confident in God. You know, what's your prayer language? Right? But sometimes prayer's hard work. Right? And sometimes the hardest work in praying is keeping your mind focused on God. Right? I mean, this is a true story. I can walk in a room, forget why I walked in there. Can I get a witness? Everybody. Open the refrigerator and don't. It can't be mayonnaise I wanted, because, you know, whatever. You just. But then I can kneel down to pray, and I start remembering all kinds of stuff except what I want to pray for. All right? Oh, that's where I left my tape measure. Right? Sometimes prayer is hard work. Genesis chapter 32. Jacob wrestled with God all night. Okay? He didn't sit and talk to him all night. He wrestled. They wrestled all night. And he said something fantastic. He said, "I'm not going to let you go till you bless me." Friends, we need to be that determined in prayer. That I'm not going to let go, God, until I get this blessing. Now, something interesting happened. God grabbed a hold of him, took his hip out of joint, and he limped for the rest of his life. Here's the point. When you really wrestle with God, when you get your breakthrough with God, when you get your blessing with God, you'll never walk the same. It'll be different. It'll be a victorious walk. But friends, you know, not you guys, but Christians that go to other churches, they give up after 2 minutes of prayer. Sometimes we got to wrestle all night. Sometimes we got to spend our time in that garden of crushing to get that victory, right? Let's keep going here, because point number four, and that is obedience, surrendering to God's will. Jesus said, if there's another way to do this, let's do it another way. But nevertheless, not my will, but your will be done. Friends, that's the greatest faith prayer ever. Not my will, Father, but your will be done. To drink the cup means to go through an experience, and most of the times that experience is a difficult experience. In the Bible, this was just a fun little study. Check this out. In the Bible, we find the cup of trembling or suffering, Isaiah 51. In the Bible, we find the cup of salvation, Psalm 116, 13. In the Bible, we found the cup of comfort. This is an awesome one, Jeremiah 16, 7. We find the cup of joy, Psalm 23, 5. We find in Psalm 11, 6, the cup of judgment. We also see in the book of Revelation, we have the bowls or the cups, same word, of judgments. So there's a lot of different cups in the Bible. You know, not so much now, but it used to be trophies were only cups on the top. Remember that? And the reason they were only cups is because they symbolize the trials and the suffering and the hard work that it took to win this thing, right? When I was a kid, you didn't get a trophy for being bad at soccer, right? Only the top ones got the trophy, right? So there's a lot of cups. Clay, where are you going with this lesson? Are you just trying to tell us you weren't good at sports? I think you guys can tell that by looking at me. Here's the lesson. The lesson, friends, is we don't have to fear whatever cup God gives us. It might be a difficult cup. It might be a victory cup. It might be a cup of trembling. But if God gives us the cup, we can trust God. For the overhead, please, Hebrews 13:2. It says, don't forget to entertain strangers, for by doing so, some of you have unwittingly entertained angels. Where are you going with that, Clay? Well, check this out. In verse 43, after Jesus says, I'll take this cup. Look at verse 43. Then an angel appeared to him from heaven, strengthening him. Friends, God will strengthen us. But when did the angel come? After he surrendered his will to the Father and said, I'll take this cup. Friends, when we're struggling with something, when we're struggling with God, it's when we give our will to God and say, I accept this cup, Father, and I trust you with it. That's when the comforting will come. And if God has to, he'll send an angel. One cool thing about this scripture is, I think it'll be fun when we get to heaven to find out how many experiences with angels we really had. That'd be kind of, you hope you weren't a jerk, right? Like, oh, that was you? You know. This verse haunts me after. I threw a fit in Home Depot once. And you too? Is that what someone said? Me too? I can't go in Home Depot anymore. But I threw this monster fit. It was good. And I look down, I'm wearing a Jesus shirt. Where was I? Oh, God was... talk about a cup of aggravation. Go to home. It's orange. I don't even use an orange highlighter anymore. I just can't do that. I can't do it. God strengthened him, but he didn't take the cup away. God may not take your cup away, but he'll strengthen you through the cup. Make sense? So he was strengthened through this. Verse 44, and being in agony, he prayed more earnestly. When he surrendered to the will, God, I'm going to do this. And even more agony came upon him. We see some of his flesh coming out. I mean, he was a man, even though he was God. And he was wrestling with this. And he prayed even more earnestly that it affected him physically. Check it out. Then his sweat became like great drops of blood falling down to the ground. This very dangerous condition. Hematosiditis, or I'm not sure I can say it right, but it's an actual thing where the capillaries burst, and the cause of that is anxiety and stress. And here he's praying, and I mean, just wow, right? And he's praying, and then verse 45, he rose up from prayer, and he came to his disciples, and he found them sleeping from sorrow. I tell you what, there's times that I feel like I've let God down. There's been a couple times that something has happened, and I'll think back, you know, I had an encounter with that person, and you all would not know the individual, you wouldn't even be familiar with the situation, but an individual took their own life. This happened a few years ago, and I'd had an opportunity to visit with this individual, obviously before it happened, and I never talked to him about Jesus. I was busy. I was just too busy. And this verse kind of haunted me. You know, here I was asleep, and Jesus really needed me. And amen, right? But it made me realize that there is nothing more important. There's nothing that Clay is doing that's more important than sharing the hope and the message of Jesus Christ with somebody. So you lose your spot in line at Fry's. The earth is going to keep rotating. Right? You know what I'm saying? Okay. He's asleep, and we find out from the other Gospels, and I'll bring this up next week when we get into this, that he actually finds him sleeping three times. He comes back, wakes him up, and goes and prays, and it actually happens three times. Here in verse 46, and we'll close up today with this, it says, and he said to them, why do you sleep? Rise up and pray, lest you fall in temptation. Pastor, I'm really struggling with pornography. Are you praying about it? Hey, you're not going to get victory over temptation unless you pray about it. Or it could be anything. I mean, there's a lot of stuff going on, right? But you see the importance of prayer? Important prayer. Let me just read these next ones, give you a couple of hooks for next week. That way you'll come back. And then we'll look at it deeper next week. But verse 47, and while he was still speaking, behold, a multitude. And he who was called Judas, one of the 12, went before him and came and drew near to Jesus to kiss him. We know how Jesus had betrayed him and how he set up this sign to let him know which one was Jesus. And here we come into that scene. In verse 48, Jesus said to him, Judas, are you betraying the Son of Man with a kiss? Proverbs 27:6 says, faithful are the wounds of a friend, but the kisses of an enemy are deceitful. Friends, realize this, that a kiss is a sign of commitment, affection, and loyalty. In a wedding, when the preacher says you may now kiss your bride, it's not just because we want to see you getting all goofy. Okay? It's just as important and has just the same amount of magnitude as that ring. You're giving that symbol of loyalty, of devotion, as far as and affection. One last scripture, and I promise I'm closing this up. 1 Kings 19:18. The prophet of God is having a little pity party with God. You guys ever have a pity party? Yeah? No one ever shows up, do they? And I throw good pity parties. I'm good at it. But God's like, pfft. Anyway, the prophet is having a pity party to God, and he tells God, I'm the only one left. I'm the only one here that cares about you. I'm the only one serving you. You guys ever feel that way? I'm the only one who cares, God. God says, hey, dude, man up. I've reserved 7,000 in Israel whose knees have not bowed to Baal and every mouth that has not kissed him. The kiss was important. It was a sign of devotion. Our Catholic friends kiss the rings of their priests and their popes and stuff, which they should not be doing. But it's very important. That's why Jesus said, you would betray the Son of Man with a kiss? Yes. That's the ultimate betrayal. And friends, all the cruelty of the cross, the pain of the whippings and the pain of the spikes in the head and the spikes in the hands and Everything Jesus went through, the most painful part of that crucifixion was that kiss. Was that kiss. Well, on that happy note, shall we pray? Worship team, join me up. Everyone stay seated just for a minute, because I want to have one more special time of prayer before we open the altars. I'm going to ask Steve and Karen to come up here. Our good friends have been part of our fellowship family for many years, are moving to the cool country, and we're jealous. And I just want until January. Yeah, when you're shoveling snow, remember this day, brother. We just want to pray a prayer of release and blessing on them. They have this great opportunity to move, and it's going to be a great opportunity for them. We're going to miss you guys. You're an important part of our family. And before we open our altar for prayer, would you guys just join me as we release them and bless them from our fellowship? Just extend your right hand out, and let's just pray. Father in heaven, we just want to thank you for doors that you open and blessings that you give, Lord. And Father, right now, we just release the Duff family to you for this next adventure that you have opened up for them, Lord. We pray that you would direct, guide, protect, and provide for them, Lord God. Father, I just ask that you'd use them in a powerful way and in their new home, Lord God. And Father, just now as their church family that love and care for them, we now release them to you, Father God, and trusting you to do great and mighty things in their life. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you guys. God bless you guys. We'll talk to you in a minute. Now stand. And let's get ready to pray. If you're visiting with us, we're just working our way through the Bible. We're studying God's word, and we try to see how it fits into our life. And at the end of our study, what's happening now is the worship team's going to lead us in a song. And we open up the altars for prayer. My wife Kelly joins me up here. The fellows Gilbert and Andrew join me up here. And we just invite you, if you have a prayer need, if something going on, if you need some agreement in prayer, we open the altars for prayer. That only lasts usually the length of a song, unless the Lord starts really doing something that lasts longer. And if you need to be dismissed, that's fine. We just ask that you be considerate and aware of what's going on up here. But what we do is at the end of our altar time here, one of the fellows will pray us a dismissal prayer. And the prayer room will always be open after service. If you need a little bit more time, maybe you need to talk to one of us, get a little bit more deeper information, we welcome that too. Okay? Let's pray and then we'll open the altars. Father in heaven, once again, we thank you for this wonderful day you've given us. And we thank you for the privilege and the opportunity to study your word. Father, today, as always, Holy Spirit, we pray that you'd continue the teaching. As we meditate and dwell upon the portion of the word that we looked at today, Holy Spirit, would you enlighten us even more? Father, speak to us individually. Is there something in our life we need to change? Holy Spirit, we give you permission to bring it to our attention. Holy Spirit, we give you permission to do divine surgery if needed in our hearts, Lord God. Father, I pray that today, Lord, you would break down walls that might be hindering us from taking that next step of obedience for you. Father, I pray that today you would break chains that might be binding us. Father, I pray that today you would heal wounds that might be affecting us, Lord. There might be wounds in families, wounds in finances, wounds in education or job, whatever it is, Lord. We pray that today you would heal those wounds, Lord. Father, today move powerfully in our life, I ask. And Lord, if there's anyone here today who doesn't know you as their Lord and Savior, and in spite of the words that I've said today, Lord, they have realized that they need a relationship with the God of heaven through his Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. I pray that today you'd open their heart and that today, Lord, they'd come forward and accept you. Father, do a great work, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.